Hello and welcome to another Cracking Expert Insights video. I'm Ali Selby and today I'm joined by Michael Maughan. He's the head of Tyndall Australian Share Income Strategy. Today we're talking about dividends, where the traps are and where you can find sustainable growth in the future. Thank you so much for joining me today, Michael. Such a pleasure as always.
Thanks, Ali.
First up, I want to talk about some of those kind of typical stocks in investors' portfolios, you know, Telstra, the big four banks and the iron ore miners. They've really become staples in income investors' portfolios. Do you think these companies will continue to pay out sustainable dividends in the future?
Yeah, well, when we go through that list, I think when the miners have been the biggest part of the dividend pie over the last few years. The iron ore price is still above $100. It's lower than it was, but when we look at it against history and we look at it against where we think iron ore will be long-term, still very high. So we expect them to be good cash flow generators and big payers going forward. The banks are in a kind of period where they do have a positive tailwind. There's not a lot of growth there, but they do have a positive tailwind in terms of margins because of rising rates. Mm. But the more exciting part of that group, that boring group, is Telstra, where you know it's had a change in its, in the short term, its core business, its return to growth. The mobile business is growing and the headwinds from the NBN are behind it. And then in terms of the sort of more medium term, it's probably one of the few companies we expect will have capital management and material returns to shareholders from asset sales because it has infrastructure assets, fixed infrastructure assets it's looking to sell. If you go back to when they sold their towers business, that was a return of over $1 billion to shareholders, and the fixed assets are more than five times the size of that.
We talked about some dividends that are growing and sustainable. Let's talk about some traps. Can you explain to our readers what a dividend trap is?
Yeah, sure. I mean, to me, there's two types of dividend trap. There's the cyclical aspect and there's the structural slash specific aspect. The cyclical aspect is, you have companies that are going through cycles. The miners are a classic example, times where the iron ore price is high and times when it's lower. If you were to value that company off, last year's earnings when the iron ore price was $220, that might not be the best benchmark to use in which to value the company. And that came to bite, if you go back to a period like 2016 for the miners as a classic example of that. On the structural side, it's more a fact of, if you think about, say, the discretionary retailers, if you value them without considering the fact that the world has changed with online retail, then you will be using the wrong benchmark to value them. It'd be the same as valuing a media stock without considering the fact that Google's completely changed the world when it comes to how people advertise. Mm. So it's not that any of these are good or bad companies, it's just that that's not the right benchmark to use last year's profits or any one year's profits to value that company.
Some of the highest yielding stocks in the market over the past year have actually underperformed the rest of the market. It's the likes of RF1, Magellan Financial Group and FMG. Would you consider these to be dividend traps?
Yeah, I think it's interesting because the fund managers fall into are susceptible to both of those types of dividend trap. They're cyclical in that they're subject to markets going up and down. If you're to use the yield of a fund manager based on the peak of the market, then that would be the wrong number, and the same if you're using the bottom of the market. But they're also subject to the structural specific aspects. If you think about flows, if you've had poor performance or you've got some brand issues and your flows are negative, last year's profits are not that relevant as a means of valuing a company, that's for sure.
How about Fortescue?
Yeah, well, Fortescue, I think, is... It falls into that same bucket with the miners. Yes, I would definitely not use last year's yield as a way to value the company, but obviously the market isn't because a yield in the high teens is obviously too high. So if the market were using a yield, then the stock would be much higher.
Okay, to finish off the interview today, I'd love to know one piece of advice you have for income investors right now.
Yeah, well, I think you've got to be very careful in using yield in isolation as a way to pick stocks. If you look historically, yield on its own isn't a great indicator of value. You need to combine it with some measure of value and some measure of quality to assess the sustainability of a dividend. You know, we've got a team of 12 leveraging 250 years of combined experience to forecast forward. Instead of looking back, we're looking forward. What cash flows is this company going to generate going forward? And that's going to drive the dividends.
Okay, thank you so much for your time today, Michael. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thanks, Ali.
If you enjoyed that video, remember to give it a like and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We're adding new content every week.